Hi, I'm Andrew Simpson, a composer, performer, and improviser based in Washington, D.C., and this is Afterglow, a weekly web series putting music in touch with history and culture. March is Women's History Month, and as part of that, this week I'm going to talk about an episode from the women's suffrage movement. We know that the 19th Amendment gave women the right to vote in 1920. But what's amazing to me is how long it took for that amendment to become reality. The persistence of generations of women is unbelievable. Susan B. Anthony and many others worked for decades to empower women and improve their condition. The Seneca Falls Convention in 1848 was a founding event in the movement for women's suffrage. The movement gained followers across the country, but Congress was slow to act. It wasn't until Senator S.C. Pomeroy of Kansas introduced the first suffrage amendment in 1868. The Senate did not take it up. And so, it is not until Tuesday, January 25th, 1887, fully 19 years after Senator Pomeroy's introduction, that I begin the story. The United States Senate held its first debate and vote on the question of women's suffrage that day. I will read excerpts from the Congressional Record on that debate using actual words spoken. The Senate had only 75 members in 1887. Senator Henry Blair of New Hampshire, a supporter of suffrage, begins the debate. He said, "Mr. President, I ask the Senate to proceed to the consideration of Order of Business 122, being the Joint Resolution SR5, proposing an amendment to the Constitution of the United States, extending the right of suffrage to women. In this day, when woman has demonstrated that she is fully the intellectual equal of man in the profound as well as in the politer walks of learning, in art, science, literature, and, considering her opportunities, that she is not his inferior in any of the professions or in the great mass of useful occupations, it is unreasonable to deny to woman the suffrage in political affairs upon the false allegation that she is wanting in the very qualities most indispensable and requisite for the proper exercise of this great right." In reply, George Vest of Missouri, an opponent, said as part of his remarks, "Women are essentially emotional. It is no disparagement to them that they are so. There are spheres in which feeling should be paramount. There are kingdoms in which the heart should reign supreme. That kingdom belongs to woman. The realm of sentiment, the realm of love, the realm of the gentler and holier and kindlier attributes that make the name of wife, mother, and sister next to that of God himself. I would not, and I say it deliberately, degrade woman by giving her the right of suffrage. Sir, if it be said to us that this is a natural right belonging to women, I deny it." Senator Vest then presents a long list of prominent men opposed to women's suffrage. Among the names are Charles Eliot, president of Harvard University, Louis Brandeis, after whom that university would be named, and Henry Cabot Lodge, later a senator from Massachusetts. Senator Blair then asks that earlier testimony given before two Senate committees be entered into the record. I am now reading from testimony given before the Select Committee on Woman Suffrage, United States Senate, March 7, 1884, 3 years earlier. Among the women testifying were Susan B. Anthony of New York, Mrs. Mary Seymour Howell, also of New York, and May Wright Sewell of Indiana. Susan B. Anthony said, "Mr. Chairman and gentlemen of the Select Committee, this is the 16th time that we have come before Congress in person, and the 19th annually by petitions. Ever since the war, from the winter of 1865-66, we have regularly sent up petitions asking for the national protection of the citizen's right to vote when the citizen happens to be a woman. I do not come to you to petition for special legislation or for any more amendments to the Constitution because I think they are necessary, but because 75 of you say there is not in the Constitution enough to protect me. Therefore, I ask that you should go forward to make more Constitution." Mrs. Mary Seymour Howell of New York said in her testimony, "I ask you also for the ballot that I may decide what I am. I stand before you, but I do not know today whether I am legally a person according to the law. It has been decided in some states that we are not persons. So I should like to know whether I am a person, whether I am an inhabitant, and above all, I ask you for the ballot that I may become a citizen of this great republic." May Wright Sewell of Indiana says, "My friend has said that men have always kept us just a little below them where they could shower upon us favors, and they have always done that generously. So they have. But gentlemen, has your sex been more generous in its favors to women than women have been generous toward your sex in their favors? Neither one can do without the other. Neither can dispense with the service of the other. The men of this nation are rapidly finding that they cannot dispense with the service of women in business life. I know that they are also feeling the need of what they call the moral support of women in their public life and in their political life. Returning to January 1887, Senator Blair also asks that testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee from Friday, January 23, 1880, fully 7 years earlier, be attached to the record. On that occasion, Susan B. Anthony was again present. A final speaker I will quote from that meeting was Caroline Gilkey Rogers of New York. In part, she said, "Our demand for the ballot is the great onward step of the century, and not, as some claim, the idiosyncrasies of a few unbalanced minds. Every argument that has been urged against this question of women's suffrage has been urged against every reform. Yet the reforms have fought their way onward and become a part of the glorious history of humanity. So it will be with suffrage. You can stop the crowing of the cock, but you cannot stop the dawn of the morning. And now, gentlemen, you are responsible." The amendment for which the women were asking would have been the 16th Amendment to the Constitution. Eventually, the amendment giving women the right to vote was the 19th. Two amendments intervened, including the 18th, which established prohibition. And so, on January 25, 1887, the United States Senate voted on the proposed 16th Amendment. The result? 16 in favor, 34 against. The presiding officer said, "Two-thirds have not voted for the resolution. It is not passed." 19 years after the first introduction to the Senate, and 39 years after the Seneca Falls Convention, the suffrage effort's first Senate vote was soundly defeated. But the suffragists did not quit. They persisted, they organized, they marched, they sometimes got arrested, and would not give up their cause. But it took so very long. Finally, the 19th Amendment passed Congress on June 4, 1919, 32 years after the 1887 debate. The 19th Amendment was ratified by the states on August 26, 1920. By that day, all of the characters I have quoted in this story were dead. Susan B. Anthony died in 1906, 14 years before the goal was reached. Two of them, Senator Blair and Sewall, lived to see the amendment passed by Congress. Senator Blair died March 14, 1920. The last to die, Mayright Sewall of Indiana, died on July 22, 1920, just 35 days before ratification.
Thank you. Be safe and well.